someone said to me we needed to talk. I was brutally dumped by an ex. Don't drag it out. Just rip the band-aid off quickly and end it.
It's great to see so many people here tonight. Welcome to bingo.
Leanne said that I'd meant the world to Luke. Luke was such a great friend of mine. Then she dropped a bomb that exploded any illusion of my place in the world. Luke had been in hospital for most of the past year. He was riddled with infections. A month before he died, he sent me a text saying he needed to talk with me.
27, room 7, stairway to heaven.
Luke and I talked a lot that day. We talked about the big stuff. Life, love, and death. The stuff that mattered. Luke was in tears speaking with me. He knew he was dying. Although he was broken, he believed he'd be at peace. He believed he'd be in a better place. But his tears weren't for him. He told me in his heart he wanted to do more for others before he died. He wanted to be an example. The kids coming through, whose DNA was dripping in death. He wanted to encourage them, to give them hope that living with cystic fibrosis didn't mean a death sentence. But for Luke, and most of my friends with cystic fibrosis, that's what it has been. A death sentence.
Number 9, just 9, doctor's orders.
You're born with cystic fibrosis. It's in your DNA. The disease is relentless. It's like an unwelcome uncle who comes to stay a night and never leaves. An all-pervading nightmare that leaks into all facets, every pore of your life. In my 20s, my doctor, looking at my chest x-ray, said I had the lungs of a 65-year-old woman who'd smoked 2 packets of cigarettes a day since she was a kid. Being a non-smoker, that made no sense to me. I took the pamphlets and the referrals he gave me, shoved them in my pocket and left. Only 1% of people with cystic fibrosis will live into their 60s. For most, life is cut short in their 40s. New drugs may change that, but right now, grandparenting, saving, planning how you're going to live your life, these aren't top of mind for most with this scourge of a disease.
70, 7-0, 3-10.
In his final days, Luke uttered very few words. So when he spoke, everyone gathered around to listen. Leanne leant towards me at the funeral and spoke. She said, Luke said, I'm scared for May. I'm scared she'll be left alone.
One, number one. One, only one. One by itself. One.
Left alone. That phrase paralysed me. When I was born, kids with cystic fibrosis were lucky to live to their teens. Tell that to a mum. I'm told I'm lucky. I'm one of the oldest people living with the disease. I prefer the longest surviving. It has a certain je ne sais quoi.
Number 7. 7 on its own. Lucky 7.
A couple of medical students were writing a case report on me for their final year exams. They sat beside me in my hospital bed and were asking me questions about my long medical history. One of them looked up from his clipboard and asked curiously, what's your lung function now? I said, as a matter of fact, 18%. He paused, looked at his colleague and said, with a head full of knowledge, that's in the severe range? Oh yeah, right, got it, severe. Severe. I relayed that story to some friends of mine while we were waiting in a cystic fibrosis clinic. They all laughed. Yeah, right, said one of them. Severe. That's an understatement. And they laughed. Those two would go on to save many lives in years to come.
43, number 43. Down on your knees.
My lungs were failing me. I've never forgotten that. Not being able to breathe, feeling my body was decaying at such a rapid rate. It felt out of control. I was running out of time. I got down to 11% lung function. At that point, you're barely alive. You need help to eat, to push yourself. I caught a glimpse of myself in the hospital mirror. My legs were twigs. I sat down on the lid of the toilet seat and sobbed. Tears rolled down my face. My hospital gown was drenched. Cystic fibrosis never sleeps, nor rests. It never lets up. I had nothing left in me. Nothing, that is, except for a glimmer of hope.
Number 68, 68, saving grace.
I knew hope. Hope had carried me down the pits and valleys of my life. This time I dragged hope down a path both of us were uncertain of. A path that was as much terrifying as it was uncertain. Standing at the edge of eternity, hopeful of how my journey would play out, whatever path it took. Weeks away from dying, I was told my only option for survival was a double lung transplant. That didn't come without risks. A transplant is, or was, a solution, not a cure. I was told by medical staff I'd only have a 50% chance of surviving if I went ahead with it. My new lung's not rejected. I thought, 50% chance of living another 5 years. You beauty, I'll take that.
85, 85, staying alive.
It was late at night. The nurse had just left after setting up a new lot of IV antibiotics. I was exhausted. Yet couldn't sleep. The word hope kept flickering in my head. It's all I had to hold on to. Everything that once seemed so important in my life, my dreams, my work, my goals, my loves, my friends, even my family, disappeared into the recesses of my mind. As I lay there, trying to sleep, a dream, if you like, a vision, took hold of me. I was alone, lying prostrate on the valley floor. Been living my life soaked in the sediment that lived there. It was pitch black, cold, and mouldy. I didn't have the strength to move. Suffocating. I heard something, someone calling out to me, telling me to lift my head. With all my strength, I tried to tilt my head consciously and deliberately out of the mire. As I did, I saw a white shard of light streaming down towards me. Right then, I knew I would be okay, no matter what happened. A few days later, my husband and daughter took me to my pre-transplant interview. As my husband parked the car, my 9-year-old daughter pushed me in my wheelchair to meet the transplant team. specialist took one look at me and said I needed to be listed immediately. 3 days later, I received a call that would change my life forever. A nurse burst into the ward in the dead of night and said, "They have a set of lungs for you. The ambulance is on its way." One person's sacrifice became my salvation. As I was being rolled into the theatre, I couldn't stop smiling. I looked around at the surgeons and said, "Whatever happens, it's going to be okay."
31, 31, get up and run.
A couple of weeks later, I was out of hospital, breathing at 100% and walking 5Ks of coastline with my running idol, Pat Farmer. We talked about my journey to my transplant. One, he said he'd reflected on when he ran across India. 6 months after that walk, I ran in my own distance event. The first I'd competed in for 30 years. 6 years post-transplant, I've lived well past my cystic fibrosis and transplant use by day. But Luke was right. In the world of cystic fibrosis, I feel somewhat alone. I'm in the 1% of the 1%. Being given a second chance at life, still living with this black cat cloud of perpetual death hanging over me, I've learned many things. The value of life. And for the people I love, particularly those close to me, the three lessons stand out. Hold on to hope. Be content in all things. And never, ever give up.
Number 41, 41. Time for fun.
Bingo.